Dear family in Christ, may the Lord fill your hearts with his rich grace, mercy, with his love, and may it overflow in you each and every day. Amen. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you for granting us the gift of your love to share with one another, your kindness that we have each and every day. Lord, as we continue this journey to hope, that we would always know that it is never alone, but that you are always with us. Help us to know that this life together is a precious gift from you, an opportunity to share your love. Lord, may we always be reflectors of your grace and your mercy, so that others too may come to know you as Lord and Savior. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Many of you, whether you grew up on a farm or not, are familiar with the term pecking order. I don't know about you, but my parents used to use this term all the time. Since I did not grow up on a farm, I wanted to make sure I understood it exactly right, although it kind of is self-explanatory. But just in case that you all want the full explanation, a pecking order is when hens are in a hen house. As you know, we usually have many hens together. Roosters have to be separated, but hens can be together. And, well, after a short time of living together, hens together, one of them will emerge dominant. And she will peck the other hens if they irritate her, or if they get in her way, or if she's just in a bad mood. And so the other hens will at first try to retaliate. They'll try to peck back at this hen unsuccessfully. And eventually then, this is what starts the pecking order. After they are unable to retaliate on that first hen, they go on to the next strongest, goes on to the next weakest, and so on and so forth. So you go to the strongest to the weakest, strongest, all the way until you get to the bottom of the pecking order. And then you end up with the one at the bottom. The one who avoids conflict, who makes a run for it if she thinks conflict is coming. And that is where pecking order originated from. I suspect that we could say that maybe the apostles today were trying to hammer out a bit of a pecking order in Mark chapter 9. Here they were traveling to Capernaum, and they were on the road together. Now, Mark, he doesn't tell us what was going on, what was part of their conversation, but he does tell us that as time went on, that they were arguing. They were arguing about who would be the greatest. Now, we don't know how this argument started. Maybe it was earlier in Mark 9. We know that the three of the disciples, Peter, James, and John, they got to go up in the Mount of Transfiguration. So maybe they were talking about that, or maybe it was the fact that the nine who remained down below were unable to drive out a demon, and they were talking about that. Whatever the case may be, we know that as they were traveling, an argument ensued. Now, when Jesus confronted them about this argument, notice none of them had anything to say. All of them were quiet then. Jesus asked them, "What were you all talking about?" as if he didn't know. And of course, he knew that they were arguing about who would be the greatest. Now, however that started, whether it started because of the transfiguration or because of the driving out of a demon, we know that the argument was going on. We know that they were irritated, or at least trying to decide who was above the others. And maybe it started out as something as simple as, well, it was really neat to see God in his glory. Maybe it started out as it was really interesting to see the driving out of the demon and how Jesus was able to do it when no one else was. Maybe it did start out as a casual conversation, a mundane conversation, but quickly turned into a serious squabble. Has that ever happened to any of you all? You start out just talking about mundane things, talking to a friend about the weather, about how things are going. You start to think about some of the things that have happened during the week and talking about those, some of the achievements of your children and your grandchildren. And before long, what started out as just a conversation becomes this, who's better, who's better, who's better? Pecking order starts to form. Maybe it doesn't turn into an all-out, drag-out fight, a pulling of hair and calling of names, but maybe you walk away saying, she just won't listen to a word I have to say. He is so unreasonable. We all know that. We've been in discussions like that, haven't we? We've had those kind of discussions before where they started out as casual but turned into serious disagreements. And we know that's part of, unfortunately, our lives together. Unfortunately, our lives together so often turn into these comparisons, side by side, who's greater than the next. They lead to pecking orders that form where, well, it doesn't stop with the argument, does it? But then we take our frustrations home and take it out on our spouse and on our children, and our irritations come out in other places as well. Before long, that pecking order continues. And life together, instead of being a beautiful picture, paradise, in reality, it becomes this place of havoc. We see this life together and it becomes difficult, hard, full of brokenness and full of difficulties. Now, this would be interesting to us, except we know that from the beginning this was the case. From the beginning, we know that life together was never easy. Solomon actually tells us about some of the things, about the difficulties that come with life together. In Solomon, Proverbs chapter 6, he writes, "There are six things that the Lord hates, seven that are an abomination to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that make haste to run to evil, a false witness who breathes out lies, and one who sows discord among his brothers." All those things create divisions, divisiveness. But did you catch that last one? An abomination before the Lord. Something the Lord hates and detests is someone who stirs up dissension and discord among fellow brothers and sisters. It's one who causes trouble, one who stirs up trials, who intentionally creates problems. It's not so interesting to us because we know people who do this, both intentionally and unintentionally. And this is the work, the handiwork of the devil. It's the things that the Lord hates that the devil does. The handiwork of the devil can be seen all over the place, can't it? We can see it in our communities, in our world, where the devil stirs up strife among different people, differing people of different color skin and different political views. He stirs up hate and strife among nations and among their nations and their leaders. He does it in our homes. He stirs up strife among family members, among husbands and wives, slamming the doors of their hearts, refusing to communicate when they need to discuss difficulties. He does it among our families, mothers and daughters fighting with one another, fathers and sons, grandfathers and grandmothers struggling. They hold on to grudges, things, and not let go. And he does it in the church too. We see the handiwork of the devil throughout the church as well, where he causes us to fight with one another, to bicker with one another. He causes us to hold on to grudges. Even if they're years and years old, we hold on to that one thing that pastor did so long ago, and we don't let go. And that's the handiwork of the devil. The handiwork of the devil is to stir up dissension and discord. He doesn't want our lives together to be lives of pleasantness and joy, lives that we strengthen and support one another. He wants us to undermine and break down one another. And there we don't really need to ask the reason why, but the reason why is so that when we're fighting, when we're bickering, we're not doing the work of God. When we're arguing, when we're throwing our hands up in frustration, we're not going out and proclaiming the good news of the gospel. And so we are accomplishing the goals of the devil. Because when we're fighting amongst ourselves, we are not out there bringing the gospel to the world. And the devil, he wants to take people from God, and he wants to keep people from hearing the message of salvation. This is why God hates these things. It goes against the very fabric of his nature. It goes against the very being that he is. God is love. We say that so often, but think about what that means. God is love. God isn't just that he wants us to love one another, but he is love. He creates in us love. He creates in our hearts and our lives love. And so when we go against his nature, when we go against his love, we are going against his very handiwork. And isn't that interesting? Because so often in our world today, so often in our lives today, we make love this thing that has to be earned. We make love this thing that has to be, that's so disposable, that can come and go so easily. We make love this thing that, well, if we're not in the right mood, if the right feeling, well, we'll put it aside. For God, that is him. That is who he is. He is love, and everything he does out of love for us. Everything he does out of his compassion, his mercy for each one of us. In sending his Son, Christ Jesus, to this earth, he did so out of love for us. Love for all of every one of us. Those forgotten, those that the world would ignore, those who we feel do not deserve love. He came and he loved. For in his day it was tax collectors, it was teachers of the law, it was the prostitutes. But in our day, who are those who are forgotten? Who are those in our community, in our world, who don't know love? The people who smell a little different than we are. The people standing outside of food for less. The people who are standing outside of Jack in the Box. What about those right here in our own congregation? Maybe they rubbed us the wrong way at one time or another. Maybe they offended us and caused us hurt, so we avoid them. We don't talk to them. It's interesting to see that God is love. And everything he does brings his love. Most of all, he put his love into action when he sent his Son Jesus into this world. He put his love into action when he sent Jesus to die on the cross. And while we were yet poor, miserable sinners, Jesus died for us. While we were yet undeserving, Christ died for you, for me. Because God is love. Now, when we think about love in our lives together, it first has to stem from humility. Go back again to our gospel reading in Mark chapter 9. Notice how the events that followed, after Jesus confronted them and said, I know you were arguing about who was the greatest, he brings this little child in among them. Not in the sense that only a child will receive the love of God, but in the sense that the love of God is for all people, neither Jew nor Greek, neither slave nor free, neither male nor female. The gift of God's salvation is for all people. A reminder to the disciples to humble them. It's not about who they were, but it's about who they followed. And the same is true for us. It's not about who we are, but it's about who we follow. We follow the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of love and mercy. We follow him, and this is a humbling thing. Because when you think about your life compared to that which God expects of you, you know how far you have fallen, but you also know how great his grace and mercy is. That he chose you despite who you were. That is love. That is grace. And it's humbling to think about that, isn't it? It's humbling to think about the fact that none of us hold any higher position before God, but that we all come to him as poor begging servants, knowing that all of his grace is a gift. And when we approach life together with humility, then the love will naturally flow, because the love will come from the fact that all of us are on the same level, but all of us need that same forgiveness, that same grace. You know, when Paul, in our epistle reading for this morning, 9 times he repeats the same Greek word, agape. 9 times he repeats that word, love. And he talks about what that love is. Love is so much more than words that we speak. It's so much more than a disposable thing that passes away. But agape love is self-sacrifice. It's willingness to care for one another, even when it means going out of our way. It's willingness to reach out to someone in need. How does this look? Well, first of all, it looks in a marriage. This looks like that sometimes a husband or a wife has to put aside their own frustrations, their own disappointments, so that you can discuss those difficulties, that you can struggle through those trials you face together. How does this look in families? It means to let go of grudges that we've held on to for years. It means admitting when we're wrong. How does this look in our world? Well, sometimes we have to wonder what it looks like in our world because it's so rare that we see it. But when you think about what it looks like in our world, all you have to do is look at the same problems that they were having in the day of Isaiah, that as Jeff was reading this morning, all you have to do is look back and you have to see there are the hungry who are out there, there are the disenfranchised, those who are in need, there are those who feel left out from the rest of society. And we as the people of God, we have that gift of love to share with them. How does that look in our church? It means forgiveness for one another. It means caring for one another. It means praying for one another. It means going out of our way to reach out to someone we haven't seen in a while, or someone we haven't talked to for a while. It means putting aside our disappointments and our frustrations and coming together in worship as the body of Christ. Life together is not an easy thing. Life together is full of disappointments. It's full of hardships. It's full of people who will cause us offense. Life together is full of people who are sinners just as we are. But life together, we're all on this journey to hope, to the promise that we have. We're all on this journey together looking forward to the day when we'll join our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in perfection, knowing that He came and entered into this journey, that while we could not be perfect, He was perfect. While we could not stop sinning, He remained sinless, and He gave His life for us. He entered into this journey so that we would not travel this road alone, but we would travel it with Him. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus who not only hears our prayers, but walks us alongside us. What a friend we have in Jesus who not only encourages us, but gives us the greatest encouragement of all, knowing that we'll be with Him forever. What a friend we have in Jesus, knowing that He has forgiven us of every one of our sins. And truly, that is the greatest act of love. Because forgiveness does not expect anything in return. Forgiveness is given freely. When we forgive one another, it reminds us of God's great grace for us. If we want to live this life together, we need to found our lives together on the love of Christ, humbled by His forgiveness and sharing that forgiveness, reflecting His grace that all may know what He has done for us. John writes in his first epistle, "Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God abides in us, and His love is perfected in us." Our life together will not be perfect, but as we live this life together, we reflect the love of God, and others too will see Christ in their lives. They will know what a friend they have in Jesus. Amen. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we give thanks to You for Your Son, Christ Jesus. We thank You for His gracious forgiveness of our sins, for His love that He continues to rain down on us each and every day. We pray, O Lord, that we would always know that there is no end to Your love, for You are love. We pray that we would be reflectors of that love, showing others to Your promised salvation. Lord, lead us always to turn to You, to know Your forgiveness, Your grace, and Your mercy, and to show that forgiveness to others. Lord, lead us always in this life together. Lead us to know that there is an end to this journey. Hope. Hope with You forever. May this be the promise that we live with now and always. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.